Hello, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for coming to this first annual lecture of first annual Gillian White lecture. I think we need to start because I'm sure if we say that we'll wait until 7 o'clock, some people will still be coming in. So we have to start at one point. But don't worry if you find people still popping in. My name is Yen Kong Hodu, and I'm Professor of International Economic Law. And I'm really grateful to have distinguished speakers today to come and give this first very important lecture, what we think is actually very important to the school, to the university, as well as to the United Kingdom or to mankind, if we can put it that way. Why? Because the person we actually honoring or celebrating today was the first female professor in mainland UK, appointed in 1975, Professor Gillian White, and also the first in international law. Although her field was more in international economic law, but anyway, international economic law was so peripheral that time, so that her chair was called the chair in international economic law. I'm sure the speakers that will come after this introduction will be able to do justice to what I'm trying to say about Professor Gillian White than myself. So without much ado, I will just introduce our distinguished speakers tonight. We've got three persons to talk tonight about Professor Gillian White. The first will be our very Margot Brazier here, whom actually do not need any introduction. And then we'll have Maureen here, who was also a friend, very close friend to Professor Gillian White, who have a lot to talk about Gillian. And then we'll also have Professor Mary Futa from the University of Nottingham. Maybe I should talk a bit about Professor Futa, because Professor Futa is one of also very few professors, and I think also following the footsteps of Professor Gillian White in the area of international economic law. And maybe personally, something I haven't told you before, Mary, you drew me into this area of international economic law. There was a publication that you did in 1995. I'm not sure you still remember that, because you've published quite a lot in this area. And that was on remedies with regards to government procurement. That is one of those articles that I actually read that drew my attention to the area of trade. And it actually helped me in drafting my own PhD proposal. Very much. I've never told you this, but that's something that I thought this is an appropriate occasion to acknowledge you in that sense. And Mary has published countless articles in the area of trade, in the area of investment law, in the area of international monetary law as well, as books in this area. And she is one of the person who has really promoted this international economic law in the United Kingdom. And I would actually say in Europe, because international economic law is something of a new animal in Europe, because it started in the US and the Chicago School developed it quite a lot. So Mary was one of the first to pick it up here in Europe. And Mary was appointed a chair in Nottingham in 2006, and before that, Mary had done quite a lot of work with different institutions, mostly in Europe, in Amsterdam, and the European University Institute, and also the British Institute of International and Comparative Law. And also, Mary has also been fellow at Cambridge, the university. So this, I think the profile is just so long that I will spend the whole evening only talking about the achievement of Mary, and more so including your involvement in the practice of international economic law, advising international organization and government. So thank you so much for accepting this accepting this request to give the annual Gillian White Lecture, the very first one. So it's very befitting to have you here to talk about this, because personally, you've actually like followed almost similar line of similar trajectory in your career, like Gillian. And I also acknowledge here some of our former colleagues, colleagues from the University of Manchester, whom I've just realized here. And thank you so much for coming. Without much ado, please, can we put our hand together for our distinguished speaker? Thank you.
Looking around this room, I guess the women win by about 75% to 25%. So I'm going to ask you to picture what was then the Faculty of Law nearly 50 years ago this October. The new first years were about 90 students in all, and just 9 women. But 9 women in 1968 in most British law schools was actually a fairly large number. 4 or 5 was more or less the norm. And Manchester was even more unusual in having 3 members of the teaching staff who were women. There had actually been 4 just before I arrived, but Miss O'Brien went on a little frolic to the south of England and came back as Mrs. Mulholland, thank goodness, a few years later. So in 1968, there were 3 outstanding women who taught me. Diana Kloss, who forged the way for women and particularly for mothers at Manchester. A young woman called Miss Brenda Hale, I don't know what happened to her. And Dr. Gillian White, who we honour today. She was to become, I was going to put it, the second woman in the United Kingdom as a whole, but Yen Kong did it much better, the first woman on mainland Britain to be appointed a professor of law. And I first met her when she lectured to me in English legal system. Now, I'm afraid I can't pretend that the content was terribly exciting. Indeed, in 1968, the Law Society and the Bar dictated most of what had to be in a law degree, and that meant that quite a lot of it was the minutiae of procedure. So I could tell you all sorts of extraordinary things about the English court system, and they would be very boring. But Gillian was, as ever, first acknowledged that she wasn't delivering the most exciting of lectures, clear in her account, and always ready to answer even the most stupid of questions. Next year, she gave about half the lectures in public international law, a subject that was then compulsory in Manchester. Don't get ideas, Ian. Now, Gillian was a woman transformed, teaching the subject she loved. We fought the fish wars with Iceland side by side with Gillian. And we came to share her vision of a world made better by international law. I suspect by the last time I saw her a few months ago when she was clearly very ill, she too was disappointed that that vision had not come to be the case. My friend Mary was Gillian's tutee. Gillian was what we now call her academic advisor. She and others testified to Gillian's kindness towards any student in difficulty or seeking to do better. Students who didn't try or flouted the rules met a very different Dr. White. She didn't suffer fools gladly. Were a student to say to Gillian, as one did not long ago to me, that she missed a 9 o'clock seminar because she overslept, she would have given a flea in her ear and an alarm clock. After graduation, I joined the staff. And as a colleague, I came to know Gillian a lot better. She saw that the transition wasn't easy. She invited me for supper. We went to the ballet together. I learned more about her, including that she had demonstrated on several occasions against the British invasion of Suez and nearly lost her then job in the Inland Revenue as a result of her Bolshevik views. Quite difficult for Maureen and I to fit that picture with the Gillian we knew of utmost respectability. One scary dark night, when I was marking public international law scripts, Gillian and I found an answer book which had no answers to the questions. That's not unusual. But page after page of rambling, talking about death and implicit threats of suicide. Gillian drove us around Manchester till we found this deeply disturbed young man, but still alive, and we persuaded him to contact his family. When the Professor of International Law, Ben Workley, retired, Her Majesty's colleagues, male and female, all saw Gillian as his heir. But we weren't sure it would happen. We were very much on tenterhooks. Gillian didn't look like the classic Professor of International Law of that day. She had no three-piece suit, no gold watch chain, and she was completely ineligible to join the Athenaeum as a woman. Our fears proved groundless, partly because of the support of Ben Workley. Gillian was appointed. She continued the tradition of international law at Manchester, creating a vibrant community of research students from across the world, and with David Millman helping to create the first LLM in international business law, which has now grown beyond anything I think that David and Gillian and I would have dreamt of. She continued in that role until 1990, when she and her husband returned to his native Australia. Gillian and Colin had met on a Norwegian cruise somewhere in the fjords. He had just sold his sheep farm in Australia and was going on a trip around the world. They married after a whirlwind romance. I have to say, some of my male colleagues muttered a bit. Do you think she knows what she's doing? Do you think he's okay? You don't think he's some kind of fraudster? Gillian, of course, knew exactly what she was doing. And they had a very happy and long-lasting marriage. And being at their wedding was, for Rodney and I, a great joy and privilege. Gillian was, without doubt, a great scholar. I fear at the time I never really fully realised the role she played in developing international economic law. She was, to her students and colleagues, a staunch sort of support, but blunt at times if she disapproved. She had high standards of effort and conduct, and woe betide those who fell below them. She was quite frugal in her ways. She was prone to suggest that I didn't need another new dress, and that actually I should make my apple pies from scratch and not buy them from the local bakery. But in times of trouble, nothing was too much for her. She cared for decades for her elderly parents, for very many years for her mother, who had multiple sclerosis. She was deeply religious. In some ways, I think she was quite an old-fashioned woman, a devoted daughter and wife. But she planted the flag for women academics generally, for those of us who are now enjoying and thriving in academic life, and she forged the way for international economic law. And I shall never forget her. Thank you.
My first meeting with Gillian was in 1964. I met her in Cambridge at a conference. The following year, the SPTL, Society of Public Teachers of Law, held its conference in Manchester, and Gillian came, and she came round to my tutorial flat in Owens Park for a cup of tea. And her well-known bluntness was shown then, because I remember her saying, "It's a very small flat," with no malice at all, just that's the way it was. It was a very small flat. Later, she was to come to Manchester as a lecturer in international law. I studied international law as an undergraduate student with Ben Workley. It was part of, I actually rather think it's a good idea to have it as part of a law degree, but it was compulsory in those days, so we all did it. And I enjoyed international law, but I never had any direct contact with Gillian in teaching terms, though we shared supervision of students and so on. And when I returned part-time, because I was bringing up my family in 1968, I got to know her as a very pleasant and friendly colleague. I was very impressed when I learned that her path had not been as easy as that of most of us. As many of you know, she was in the civil service. She stayed at home to help her father look after her mother, who was an invalid. And at the same time, she studied in the evening at London University and obtained an outstanding first-class degree, which is very, very rare in evening courses like that. It was a great compliment to her professional ability that, having been here as a lecturer and a senior lecturer, Professor Wortley, who wasn't in the front line of feminism, you could say, nonetheless was very happy, respected and admired her prowess so much that he was very happy to bequeath to her, as he would see it, his chair in international law, and she filled it with great distinction. I remember a certain amount of excitement when we heard that Gillian had met Colin Fraser. There was a lot of rather silly imaginary talk about them meeting on board ship and looking at the sunset, you know, like Betty Davis in 1950s films. But it was certainly romantic enough. As Margot said, they met in Scandinavia, they were both on holiday. He was supposed to be going round the world, having sold his farm. But when he met Gillian, he changed his plans and came to Britain to woo her, and they were then married very happily. A lot of people thought that this was a very strange marriage because he was a blunt Australian retired farmer with no pretensions to academic or intellectual distinction, and she was a very distinguished lady. But perhaps to some people's surprise, Gillian managed her dual life with grace and happily, and then there was never any conflict between her academic studies and the fact she lived a quiet and contented life at home with Colin. We all got to like Colin. He was very much an Australian with no pretense and no side. My husband and I became friendly with them, and my husband and Colin would talk cricket while Gillian and I talked faculty gossip, probably. And he became really much loved in the faculty by all her colleagues. She was a woman of simple tastes, and she never pretended to be anything else. She was not sophisticated in her social tastes or in her food tastes. And she was a canny housekeeper, which is why she used to do the sort of thing that Margot suggested, saying, you know, do you really need to buy that? And if you met her in the supermarket, having a look at your trolley and thinking, shouldn't you have some more basic stuff in there? And that was because she was both very straight, very honest, and very kind. She was, as you have heard, a very faithful and loving daughter. She helped her father to nurse her mother, and then when her mother died, she looked after her father. And one of her great characteristics was loyalty to her family and to her friends. There is a friend who was at school with her who was still in touch with her right to the end, and we got to know her a little. She was, of course, also immensely loyal to her beloved Colin, who had an unpleasant, though not too long, last illness, and she nursed him with great tenderness. I don't think I realised how very distinguished she was in her field because of not really knowing much about the subject. And she was extremely modest and unassuming always about her intellectual and scholarly achievements. She had great moral courage. You've heard Margot mention Suez, Iceland, Iraq. She wasn't afraid to stand up for a view that might be regarded as unsuitable or unpopular by people that she worked with or people she mixed with. Her down-to-earth quality was, I think, one of the reasons why she took so well to Australian life. We were quite surprised that she settled so happily when she, having lost her father, and when she retired early, she and Colin went back to Australia. And she settled there very happily and very contentedly. Her Christmas letters were always full of the doings in Tamworth. And when people said, you know, how could she settle in a sort of an Australian small town, that there was no question of her feeling restless and unhappy with that. So She became much loved in Tamworth, and even after Colin's death, she showed no desire to come back, what she no longer thought of as home, probably. Several people said, oh, well, she'll come back to England. But she loved Australia. She loved it. She became Australian. She took to it with her customary warmth and loyalty. She paid a last visit to the United Kingdom last summer, and she stayed with John and me in our home. She was gravely ill. She didn't realise quite how gravely ill she was, but she made that last effort. She saw her old school friend. She met several other friends, and when she stayed with us, we managed to meet various friends here, including the Braziers and the Gillilands, all of whom were very pleased to see her. So it was sad in a way, but she did come and see us all once more, though she was sadly changed. Sadly, she died very soon after she went back, but she has left a great deal of warmth and appreciation and admiration. So I'm very honoured to have been asked to say these few words.
Thank you very much, Margot, Maureen. That was quite moving. I too have recollections of Gillian. That may surprise some of you. I'm not in the bloom of youth myself. I'm coming up to retirement. But let me begin by saying that it is an honour and a pleasure for me to have been invited to give the inaugural Gillian White annual lecture. And also, and this is a pleasure for me in particular, to meet some of her former colleagues, members of staff, and students from Manchester Law School. Now, my recollection of Gillian goes back to the early 1990s. She hadn't quite set foot for Australia on a permanent basis. She was backwards and forwards, and she did spend some time in the UK. At that time, I became the first fellow in public international law at the British Institute of International and Comparative Law. And I chaired the discussion group on international economic law, in which Gillian would from time to time participate. I also remember that she did take part in some of the ILA meetings as well. My recollection of her is as a stern critic, but she was also a very warm and friendly person, and she encouraged younger scholars, which I was then, like myself, particularly because of my interest in international economic law. I think it's important for us to realize how difficult it was to actually pursue a career in that field at that time. I can recall in the 1990s, someone who died in rather tragic circumstances, Professor Ian Brownlee, who had the Chicherley chair at Oxford, who said sort of, over my dead body will international economic law ever be taught at this university. And he published several editions of his Principles of Public International Law, and he refused to say anything about international economic law. The closest he'd come to that would be to deal with the rights and responsibilities of aliens, but not aliens as on the moon, those who were involved in things called foreign investment. But that gives you an idea of a flavor of where the subject stood at that point, at least with many of our colleagues in the field of public international law. That a woman should actually teach something like this was even more extraordinary. Sadly, I have to report that that situation has not changed very significantly to this day. I still find myself in the minority and sometimes as the only woman in a meeting, a committee, a gathering of other men in the field. So it's very much a niche subject for us women still, might surprise you. It's getting better, but we still need many more on our side. So in thinking about the topic for this lecture and what might be broadly representative of Gillian's contribution to the field of international economic law and international economic law scholarship, I began to focus on three of her main interests. One was dispute settlement, the other one was the new international economic order, and then as she came up to retirement, the growing trend towards regional integration. That began, of course, with the establishment of the European Economic Community in the late 1950s, with the UK joining in the 1970s. And it gathered pace as by the time Gillian came to retire with the negotiation of the North American Free Trade Agreement, which saw the light of day in 1994. As we stand now on the threshold of the UK leaving the European Union and NAFTA about to be renegotiated, we should perhaps reflect on some of these developments of almost half a century ago. Well, definitely so in the case of the European Union. But I quickly realized that the area where Gillian had made the greatest contribution in the field of international economic law was her scholarship on the new international economic order. In particular, her questioning of what was the meaning of order, economic, international, and what was new about all of this? Why call it the new international economic order? And that's basically the thrust of her 1975-76 article for the Virginia Journal of International Law, which was the point at which she assumed the chair of public international law at this university. Later on, she reflected, she looked back on the principles and trends over a 15-year period when she wrote a piece for a collection of essays on international economic law and developing states, an introduction, which was edited by Hazel Fox, who was not actually still director of the British Institute when I joined, but was still actively involved in the work of the Institute. That was published by the British Institute of International Comparative Law in 1992. I'm a little sad that I accidentally left it on my desk when I came away today. I meant to bring it with me. But taking my cue from Gillian, I plan to revisit the new International Economic Order, or the NIEO, as it's better known. And I will do so primarily from a legal perspective, but I'll also reflect on some of the economic and political conditions at the time that brought about this particular development. And for me, the question is whether the NIEO made any difference to developing countries, and indeed the emergence of the whole field of law and development, and perhaps even the right to development. And in particular, because that stands as a cornerstone of the new international economic order, where do we stand with respect to the principle of equality? If we cast our minds back just 9 months almost to the day of the morning of the referendum, and then we get Theresa May taking on the reins of government and becoming Prime Minister, one of the major thrusts of her speech was about inequality. So I will come back to that point at the end. But let's reflect for a moment then on the long-term effects of the NIEO, the effects it had, if any, on law, development, and economic process. Not just for developing countries, but for all countries, irrespective of their level of economic development. Now, my journey proceeds as follows. First of all, I want to discuss the background and the context in which the new international economic order emerged. I'll then summarize briefly the contents of that new international economic order, and note matters of law, development and economic process. I'll proceed to assess what impact it had on North-South relations and what its legacy has been in terms of law and development. And finally, I'll turn very briefly to consider what it means in today's global economy and discuss whether we're moving towards a new international economic order, and possibly one that eschews globalization or else harnesses it but moves in a new and different direction. So let me turn first of all to what was the new international economic order and how did it come about? The term itself is derived from three pieces of individual documentation, all of which are based on UN General Assembly resolutions. So there was a declaration for the establishment of a new international economic order, which was adopted by the General Assembly in 1974. It was one of the three instruments that brought about a radical change in the normative makeup of the international law of development. The declaration was accompanied by a programme of action, and then towards the end of the year in December 1974 by a charter of economic rights and duties of states. These were all soft law or non-binding instruments, so not treaty instruments, and they were pretty declaratory as well. All three of these General Assembly resolutions emerged from attempts to forge a broad-based agenda for discussion between the industrialized, developed countries, predominantly in the Northern Hemisphere. I say that because, of course, there was Australia, New Zealand, and so forth in the other part of the globe, and developing countries in the global south. Its antecedents lay in the so-called North-South dialogue for a new economic order, the origins of which can actually be traced back to the 1955 Afro-Asian Conference, which was held in Bandung, Indonesia. The Bandung Conference goals were to promote economic and cultural cooperation, to protect human rights, and to endorse the principle of self-determination. Mid-1950s, we still had a lot of countries under colonial domination. Also to end racial discrimination and to seek peaceful coexistence. The conference was sponsored by the governments of Burma, Ceylon, which is now Sri Lanka, India, Indonesia, and Pakistan. And a further 24 countries were in attendance. It sought collaboration among so-called third world nations in an effort to reduce their reliance on Europe and North America. Some have even characterized Bandung as the start of the non-aligned movement, although that only became a reality when the first meeting of the non-aligned movement was held in Belgrade in 1961. That was an initiative of former Yugoslav president Josip Broz Tito. The NIO should also be read against the process of decolonization that began in the late 1950s and gathered pace throughout the 1960s. This country, used to be called Great Britain rather than the United Kingdom, was one of those from which many countries received their independence. The other two colonial masters, or three perhaps, were France, Spain, and Portugal, and to a lesser extent, the Dutch. While the economic performance of developing countries was reasonably good in the 1950s, by the early 1960s, many of them were frustrated by their growth prospects, and they demanded a more equitable share of the benefits of the international economy. Let me turn first to trade. There were two developments in the trade sphere. One was an upsurge of new GATT developing country contracting parties who were sponsored in by their former colonial masters. That meant that they simply adopted the tariff schedule of their mother country. So all of the British, former British colonies had the UK or British tariff schedule. The other development was a growing realization by developing countries that changes were needed in order to advance their interests in the multilateral trading system. in 1963, a group of experts called for the creation, under the auspices of the Economic and Social Council, this is a UN body, of a new UN agency with universal membership and substantial powers. The idea was that it would implement the recommendation of a proposed UN Conference on Trade and Development, what later became known simply as UNCTAD, which was established in 1964. The history of the UNCTAD is bound up with the emergence of a group of 77 southern states at the second UNCTAD conference in 1968. The group of 77 self-identified as a bloc and later gave themselves the name the Group of 77. Interestingly, I found in actually conducting some research for this lecture that one of the proponents of that in the early 1960s was none other than Che Guevara, who represented Cuba. He was the Cuban delegate to the Group of 77. Interesting point. So while the G77 had no positive agenda of its own, other than cooperation in the common cause of new world order, this political initiative and the attempt by the G77 to realign international power that the process of decolonization had begun should not be underestimated. It finds resonance in the NIEO documentation, especially in the frequent reference to the principle of self-determination, although not yet explicitly articulated as a right to self-determination. That comes much later. Meanwhile, and not unimportantly, the UNCTAD pursued three main policy objectives. They sought a general framework for international commodity agreements, new forms of supplementary finance to the IMF's, the International Monetary Fund's compensatory finance facility, and temporary preferences for industrial exports from developing to developing country markets. At least two of those themes, international commodity agreements and preferential trade, preferential export trade, would become hallmarks of the NIEO and later, at least preferential trade, of the current WTO. Eventually, UNCTAD was less important for what it achieved than for the appeal it made to universalism, which might surprise some of you. The Algerian jurist and later ICJ president, Mohamed Bejoui, became the primary advocate for legal universalism when seeking a legal articulation of the NIEO's key economic objectives. Furthermore, and as a response to the growing demand by developing countries for change in the multilateral system, multilateral trading system, which was supported by the Habler Report, the GATT contracting parties adopted a new Part 4 on trade and development, which was added to the General Agreement in 1966. And a new institutional body arose in the GATT called the Committee on Trade and Development, which was specifically established to oversee developing country concerns. A further development during the charismatic decade of the 1960s was the adoption by the UN General Assembly of Resolution 1803 on permanent sovereignty over natural resources. It arose from the ongoing process of independence that had already seen developing countries acquire a numerical majority in the UN system of one state and one vote. Resolution 1803 provided that states and international organizations should strictly and conscientiously respect the sovereignty of their peoples and nations over their natural wealth and resources in accordance with the UN Charter and the principles contained in Resolution 1803. At the time, it was hailed as a breakthrough in North-South relations because significantly a number of key developed states from the industrialized Northern Hemisphere voted in its favor. However, triumph soon turned to despair when a decade later, the developing countries of the Southern Hemisphere sought to challenge the dominant players in the international economy at the UN General Assembly. And this was in their call for a new international economic order, which was first formally proposed by developing countries at a summit conference of the non-aligned movement, which was held in Algiers in 1973, and was nothing less than a demand for a fundamental restructuring of North-South economic relations. I don't think today we can actually fully appreciate the impact that this particular movement had. It was quite significant at the time, and I can understand why people like Gillian and others questioned what this was all about, because it was something very new for the developed industrialized northern hemisphere. The new international economic order was premised on the idea of developing countries benefiting from a fairer and more equitable share of global resources, a greater share in international trade, including better prices for key commodities on world markets, more say in financial and monetary affairs and debt-related issues, and the transfer of technology to boost industrial production for export. Importantly, the NIEO Declaration, Programme of Action, and the Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of States were some of the first attempts at what I would call declaratory lawmaking by the UN General Assembly. It was undertaken by a group of developing countries against the backdrop of rapid decolonization, as I've mentioned already, and newly found independence. There was really quite a lot of confidence, quiet confidence, I think, among the developing country group. And this was actually very strongly supported by the Group of 77. So they had a political fallback as well. I think one cannot begin to appreciate the new international economic order or its series of interrelated proposals for reform to the structure, governance, and norms of the global economy, which were designed to improve the relative position of developing countries without considering also the broader economic context of the early 1970s. And here I refer to what was going on in the international monetary system, because of very particular relevance was the demise of the par value system and the abandonment of the Bretton Woods fixed exchange rate. Now, that happened between 1968 and 1973. It led eventually to the second amendment of the IMF, or the Fund Agreement, in 1978. But perhaps more significantly still, the Arab oil embargo, which followed the Six-Day War and OPEC's tripling, this was a cartel of oil-producing exporting countries, its tripling of the price of a barrel of oil overnight. This sent shockwaves through world markets, given that at the time many countries were reliant on imports of oil. Countries like Japan are today still reliant 100% on oil imports. So OPEC's success served as a catalyst to pull together the developing countries in support of a call for a new international economic order in which their interests would be better represented. And this call integrated many of the proposals that had previously been discussed at UNCTAD and elsewhere, including at the G77. Before turning to a broader discussion of what the NIEO means in terms of our contemporary international economic order, let me briefly revisit the main principles and the content of it. So the main principles, the declaration for the establishment of the new international economic order seeks fundamental changes to the international system, as I said already. And it would be based on equity, sovereign equality, interdependence, common interest, and cooperation among all states, not just the developing countries, irrespective of their economic and social systems. And here we get the turn back to the colonial era. It would correct inequalities and it would redress existing injustices. So it was seen as a form of remedial justice, if you like, to remedy past injustices. It would also make it possible to eliminate the widening gap between developed and developing countries. In imagining an NIEO based on the reversal of sovereign inequality and the redressing of social and economic injustices. There are some key principles that are found in those three documents. The principle of sovereignty, expressly and more forcefully given as the sovereign equality of states, which was further articulated in the context of decolonizing countries as the principle of self-determination. The principle of equality. All of the documents speak of equality, and in many different places. In particular, they encompass the principle of preferential treatment and the principle of participatory equality. The preferential treatment was in order to equalize the disadvantaged developing countries alongside their developed partners. Also, things like the principle of solidarity and the principle of equity. As for the content of the NIEO, here I'm following Gillian's own analysis, which is drawn from her 1975 article and her 1992 contribution to the Bickel publication. The main content of the NIEO in terms of law, economics, and development can be summarized as follows. The issue of permanent sovereignty over natural resources, to which is linked the controversy surrounding the nationalization and expropriation of foreign property, and the standard of compensation in those circumstances. Secondly, the development of international trade on a preferential basis in terms of the lowering of tariffs on developing country exports of manufactures. Thirdly, the external indebtedness of developing countries and the move towards debt relief. And finally, development assistance, internal economic and fiscal reform through so-called structural adjustment policies and human rights, and most significantly, the right to development. Then I would add the following areas that also merit consideration. The American Nils Gilman has emphasized the absolute right of developing countries to control the extraction and marketing of their natural resources. Interestingly enough, even seeking to control the activities of transnational corporations. We're now facing a similar sort of debate in the field of business and human rights. This is an area of interest to me, and one in which I have done some work already. That was linked to the establishment and recognition of state-managed resource cartels to stabilize and to raise basic commodity prices. Also, a focus on the need to implement an international code of conduct for transnational corporations. So not only having transnational corporations within host countries, many of them in the extractives industry, but also to seek to regulate their activities at the international level with a code of conduct. Interesting, it didn't completely survive the UN system, and it didn't live to see another day. But as I say, it's now coming back in the form of the agenda on business and human rights, and particularly the UN guiding principles on business and human rights. And finally, the establishment of a mechanism for no strings attached technology transfers between the North and South, and the application of the common heritage of mankind concept, which is relevant to the exploitation of the deep seabed resources for the benefit, and in that case, for the benefit of developing countries. We haven't heard so much about the common heritage principle in recent times. But I think we will very shortly, because there are plenty of activities going on with respect to the deep seabed and similarly with respect to outer space and the geostationary orbit. What are the legacy, or what is the legacy of the new international economic order in terms of law, development, and economic process? On an immediate basis, in the 1970s, neither the declaration and the program of action on a new international economic order or the Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of States, which was a more robust document, had any real impact. One of the reasons for this was that lurking behind the NIEO declaration was a simple assumption that a shared interest in rearranging global economic governance provided a sufficient basis for political solidarity. And in fact, that wasn't the case. It couldn't be. The interests of the countries behind the decoration and those that supported it was too diverse for that to be possible. And it should be remembered that there was huge economic diversity even within the G77 group of countries. And that represented a political paradox of its own. I'll give you an example. I've mentioned the Arab oil embargo, the OPEC, and the OPEC raising of prices, the price of oil tripling it on world markets. And developing countries had very different views about that. Some of them were importers of oil themselves, so they suffered as a result of that tripling of the price of oil. Others were exporters and so stood to gain. So they stood on both sides of the fence. It was very difficult for many of them. But perhaps the less than favourable outcome of the new international economic order in the 1970s and 1980s was due to a power asymmetry between the developed and developing nations, and one that wasn't cured by this declaratory programme, if you like, at the UN. In the politically charged arena of North-South relations, it was also, in my view, a clash of rights versus regulation, in which developing countries clamoured for the benefits of embedded liberalism and all of the rights that went with it, and many of which much of the developed world had enjoyed in the post-war international economic order and the social conditions on which it rested. The developed countries, though, wanted to bring about regulatory change across the globe and to ensure that their form of capitalism, particularly foreign investment, also debt restructuring where it was necessary, and even the terms of trade was on their terms and primarily to their benefit. Also, we should look at the demands of the NIEO against the backdrop of the first generation of human rights norms and the entry into force in the mid-1960s of the International Covenants on Civil and Political Rights and economic, social, and cultural rights. And what comes out and what is most interesting about the whole movement, particularly when it comes to the group of 77, is that they were very much in favor of the Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, less enthusiastic perhaps about civil and political rights. And they were very much with the socialist group of countries that supported the Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. Meanwhile, the North had its own problems to contend with, as I've mentioned already, one being the changes in the international monetary system and the move to manage floating or flexible exchange rates for foreign currency transactions. Floating exchange rates that were de facto in force in the late 1960s and became law in the late 1970s were premised on the underlying supposition that exchange rate adjustments would be made where appropriate by changes in the domestic fiscal policies of IMF members so as to bring about an overall balance in the global economy. This wasn't always possible. And besides, no attempt was made to liberalise what's called the capital account of IMF members. Instead, the market would come to reign supreme from the 1970s onwards. And one explanation for this is the explosion in outward foreign direct investment by developed country investors throughout the 1970s, but particularly the 1980s and 1990s. And the increased resort to managed investment through bilateral investment treaties that were often concluded in favour of outward investment by capital exporting countries in the North. As far then as the developed industrialised countries were concerned, the Charter on Economic Rights and Duties of States included two basic and controversial propositions which led to its failure to garner their widespread support. None of them voted in favour of the Charter, and six voted against it: Belgium, Denmark, Federal Republic of Germany, Luxembourg, the UK and the US. I name those six countries because each of them already had a programme of bilateral investment treaties, and they were about to extend that. One of their complaints was that the Charter affirmed full permanent sovereignty over all of a state's wealth, natural resources and economic activities, and the a payment of appropriate compensation in the event of nationalisation, expropriation or transfer of ownership of foreign property, which had to be in accordance with the host state's laws and regulations. This was directly and diametrically contrary to the so-called Hull formula or standard of compensation, which was prompt, adequate and effective, and which, interestingly and paradoxically, developing countries have now adopted themselves in bilateral investment treaty making. Another complaint from the industrialised North was that the Charter on Economic Rights and Duties of States made it clear that primary product producers have the right to associate in producers' cartels, and other countries have the duty to refrain from efforts to break these cartels. So the industrialised North saw the OPEC cartel being replicated in all sorts of areas. And they were concerned about the desire of developing countries to manage and to price core commodities like cocoa, coffee, tea, sugar, hard fibres, jute, cotton, rubber and copper and tin, and seven other commodities with a slightly lower priority, such as bananas, wheat, rice, wool, iron ore and bauxite. The objectives of the commodity programme, which were actually supported by a UN effort to establish an international fund for common commodities, were to reduce excessive price and supply fluctuations and establish and maintain commodity prices which were equitable in real terms for consumers and remunerative to producers. And to achieve these goals, they proposed the following measures be adopted: the establishment of international buffer stocks, the creation of a common fund to finance these stocks — I've already mentioned the International Fund for Common Commodities — the signing of multilateral trade commitments, and the arrangement of improved compensatory financing to stabilise export earnings. We actually saw that with the Lome Convention in the 1970s. This is one of the conventions adopted between the African, Caribbean and Pacific nations and the European Economic Community, as it was called at the time, and the so-called STABEX program, which was a stabilization of export earnings. What is so striking about the call for a new international economic order some 40 years later is that many of the discrepancies between the developing and the developed world in terms of economic and social conditions remain the same. Some of the principles set out in the Declaration and further developed in the Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of States have not been met. For example, the need for all states to put an end to the waste of natural resources, including food products. In this country, the Institute of Mechanical Engineers just 2 years ago issued a pretty damning report about food wastage in this country, in the United Kingdom. It's astronomical proportions. And also the promotion of transfer technology and the creation of indigenous technology for the benefit of developing countries. And we should remind ourselves this famous WTO appellate body case, US shrimp, sometimes known as the shrimp turtle case. One of the challenges that the US had was against India's use of indigenous handmade turtle exclusion devices because they didn't meet US requirements on what was needed for a turtle exclusion device. That's often overlooked when talking about that particular case, but it reminds us of how far we've come. Not very far, actually. There were some instances where some of the promise of the NIAO was partially achieved. For example, the extension of active assistance to developing countries by the international community, free of any political or military conditions. I say partial because, yes, it was, there was an untying of aid in the 1980s and 1990s in particular. That was particularly important. That was reached in the DAC, the Donors Assistance Committee of the OECD, that agreement to do that. But we should be aware of how much has changed and how little, because much of that activity, I mean, a lot of aid is also given on a bilateral basis or it's given on a unilateral basis, and that allows countries to tie that to political and military conditions. And we've also seen a privatization and a corporatization of aid transfers. So that begs the question as to how successful that development assistance has been. It also soon became apparent that many of the proposed commodity schemes were not simply a proposal for stable prices, but instead led to high prices on world markets. Now, you would think that that would be a good thing for many developing countries, but you can't ultimately sustain a commodity at very high prices in international markets. Even the OPEC cartel knows that and has to occasionally adjust its policy. But for a group of developing countries, many of which were still engaged in monoculture, only producing bananas or nutmeg or something like that, or coffee, this led to the collapse of some of these commodity arrangements. And the financial costs of implementing these programs were also way beyond anything the advanced countries were willing to fund. We saw the collapse of the International Tin Council, and due mostly to the, the pretty diabolical way in which the manager, the fund manager, handled the buffer stock. That was basically how that agreement came to a sticky end. In the 1980s, the terms of trade further deteriorated for raw material exporters, and the debt problems of many of the developing countries, which had advocated for a new international economic order, meant that they remained on the back foot in international fora. However, there are areas in which the agenda for a new international economic order has made gains. One is in the context in which a developing country may seek to fulfill its right to full permanent sovereignty over its natural resources and all economic activities. And this has changed beyond recognition. What we have seen is the increased desire of many developing countries to encourage inward foreign direct investment. This has been extended not only to foreign direct investment that deals with the exploitation of natural resources while retaining permanent sovereignty over them, but also other forms of inward investment activity. There are two main trends. One is that with the rise of China and other so-called BRIC countries, the Brazil, Russia, India, China, and also you should include South Africa, there has emerged a new forms of colonial domination in resource-rich developing countries, particularly on the African continent, and also novel approaches to development. I don't have time to expand upon those, but I'm thinking of some of the ways in which China approaches development on the African continent. It leaves a lot to be desired. The other development is that bilateral investment treaties have historically been entered into by developed industrialized countries so as to afford protection to their investors in developing and transition economy markets, and then to assure that their own investors would benefit and their own countries would benefit from increased foreign investment flows. But the trend is being reversed by a huge number of South-South bilateral investment treaties that are being concluded. Evidence for this can be found just by trawling through the UNCTAD database on international investment agreements or perusing the recent investment arbitration awards. But perhaps the area of international economic activity in the NIAO agenda that has seen the most change is the issue of international trade generally and the topic of special and differential trade in particular. While there's been a substantial shift in GATT-WTO practice towards applying international law, which takes into account a state's level of economic development, rather than insisting on the traditional approach of sovereign equality and identical obligations, there remain serious doubts as to whether the international trading system has delivered net benefits to developing countries in the form of faster growth and poverty reduction. The often heard mantra at the WTO is that trade under the multilateral trading system is an engine for global growth, listen up, Department of International Trade, and that this in turn will ameliorate poverty, but the reality is somewhat different. While the Doha Ministerial Declaration of 2001 hastily ushered in a newfound confidence that WTO developing and least developing countries would finally exert greater influence over the multilateral trade agenda, the reality is somewhat different. As a result of increasing numbers of participating and to some extent influential developing countries in the WTO as compared to the GATT, combined with the thrust of the Doha Development Round agenda, there has been renewed emphasis on granting special and differential treatment to developing countries. This initially led to the inclusion of a range of special and differential treatment provisions in the multilateral trade agreements, not all of which have been fully operationalized, and the introduction of technical assistance and capacity building efforts at the WTO, which have gathered pace since the millennium. One only has to think of the Trade for Aid program or agenda, and you know what I mean. However, progress on further gains with respect to trade and development has proven limited and so far ineffectual. Despite ministers at Doha calling for a review of special and differential treatment provisions in order to strengthen them and make them more precise, effective, and operation, the WTO Committee on Trade and Development has remained divided and largely moribund on taking matters forward. And this points to one of the weaknesses of the NIAO and the G77 that lay behind it. Developing countries are not necessarily all on the same page when it comes to achieving the principle of equality. Even less so, their fulfillment of the principle of solidarity, both of which underpinned the NIAO agenda. And this is in spite of the fact that in terms of economic process, or at least the participatory nature of it, there was back in the 1970s a straightforward political desire to participate more effectively in decision-making on international economic affairs that affected all developing countries. Participation was demanded not merely to ensure that developing country interests were safeguarded, but equally to assert their rights as members of the international community, and as a desired feature of a just and fair international economic order. However, in the case of international trade, what appears to have happened is that the special and differential trade parts of the NIAO agenda have become embedded in the institutional framework of the WTO. This embedded institutionalization of what I call the development norm has led to its petrification and not its codification and operationalization, as perhaps was foreseen. I could continue. I'll just briefly remark about one other area that Gillian touched upon, and that's sovereign indebtedness, or the external indebtedness of developing countries. One area where developing countries sadly did not make progress in the new international economic order, or establishing it, was because many of them became embroiled in large-scale debt, or embroiled in large-scale with large-scale debt problems. Mexico and Brazil in the 1980s and 1990s, and later, of course, Argentina, around the turn of the millennium. Many of them were forced into programs of structural adjustment, which is basically a sort of implied form of development assistance with strings attached. Many of them were also forced down the road of what's called the Washington Consensus, conceived of by John Williamson. This was designed to get countries to think about structural reform of their economic and fiscal system, but also to abide by the rule of law, good governance, which nobody really knew how to actually define, and also to fulfill their promise to adopt human rights and democracy within their national systems. But what does the NIAO mean for today's global economy? And here I want to just reflect on the long-term impact of this particular development. So while there's been some success, times are changing, especially due to new technology and advancements in the way trade, perhaps less so investment, but monetary and financial affairs are conducted. The lines are continually being blurred between trade in goods and trade in services. At the same time, though, many multilateral rules remain largely unchanged, while the divergence between rules and practice is becoming clearer by the day. Additionally, states are gradually moving from a focus on the multilateral trading system to regional and bilateral trade arrangements, which in some cases may herald a new wave of protectionism. We anticipate this with the United States, but the UK could also fall into that category too and be seen as a very protectionist nation within a very short period of time. I believe also that we're on the cusp of a remake of the international economic order, but one that is based on the rules of a smaller association of countries by means of regional and bilateral arrangements. We might also call it coalitions of the willing, those who are willing to work together and to seek to achieve the same goals. At the same time, those arrangements stand to become more complex, catering to the mixed nature of goods and services trade and the continued need for trade to positively affect development. Finally, and I shall end on this note, we may, as Richard Baldwin has suggested in a new book, currently be in a form of post-globalization society. All the indications are there, as we know, from the Brexit vote to Trumpism. According to Baldwin, globalization has taken shape over the last decade or two in three stages, through the ability to move goods, ideas, and people. And nowhere is this better exemplified than in the current trade and financial and monetary regimes. To this, I would add that the mantra, international trade is a win-win situation, is seriously overstated. For while international trade makes countries better off, it does not necessarily raise all boats. In other words, the benefits from trade for both developed and developing countries are unequally distributed across individuals and over time. In fact, there may be greater inequality today than perhaps in the last 10 or 20 years. And I think this is actually what Theresa May was referring to in the case of the United Kingdom. We've moved towards greater levels of inequality at all levels of society. Whereas there were relative gains to be had from trade in goods and more latterly from services, the future looks rather different. Technology and the use of robotics are about to prove, perhaps, in Baldwin's view, to be the most disruptive forces in a post-globalization era. It's this development that, above all, may force us to rethink and reshape the international economic order and to start doing things in ways we never previously imagined. It may also inadvertently bring about greater equality between developed and developing countries. I'd be happy in discussion to give you some examples and to talk more about that. But for the moment, I think I will rest my case. I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this very interesting and thought-provoking lecture, Mary. Thank you for taking us back some decades ago and then projecting the future and also talking about the remnants of international economic order. I think we'll take some few questions and then before we head out for something else. Who will start? Okay, Neil, Ian, and then Shavana, and then, yeah.
Ladies first, it's a ladies evening.
Oh, right, yeah, you're definitely right, yeah, so, yeah.
Hello, thank you so much. It's always a pleasure to hear you speak, Mary, so thank you for I think your talk really highlighted the blurring of the lines between the public and the private, and whether we're in the globalisation process or the post-globalisation process, I think that sort of stands. I want to touch upon a small area of your talk, particularly in relation to the business and human rights issue. Obviously, you know, the Ruggie principles have the, I suppose they talk about the protection of human rights by states and companies, TNCs, having to respect human rights. In this sort of new economic order, do you think we could get to a point where actually TNCs could actually move to protecting human rights? Obviously, you know, various initiatives, EITI, for example, various investor restrictions. I suppose the broader question is what international obligations could be implemented for these non-state actors that are clearly having a seriously sovereign character about them?
What would you like me to do? To take a series of
questions? Yeah, a series of questions,
yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So. Yeah.
I suppose it really shouldn't surprise you to know that I was first up international economic law by a woman. That was Robin Byrne at the Australian National University. However, my question is really quite simple, Mary. Do you think that the new international economic order tried to do too much too soon?
It was
simply
over-ambitious
for the time.
Okay. Should we take three?
Do you want to take three? Yeah, three. Yeah,
yes.
Okay. Neil.
Hi, thanks very much for such an interesting lecture. I'm no specialist, so I suppose my question is going to be very general. What I noticed from your discussion was that the United States is there as a backdrop, but isn't made explicit, I think, in your discussion. So yeah. I was hoping maybe you could reflect a little bit on the significance of the United States to the historical period that you discussed. And I suppose my connected question then, I thought it was something that's quite striking, and I've been thinking about it myself from just news reports. I'd really like to hear more about what your thoughts are on Chinese dominance in Africa. You did say that you weren't that impressed, and I'd like you to elaborate a little bit more on that, if you could.
Sure. Okay, let me take those questions in the order in which they were posed. So to come to Shivana's question first, you may be aware, I'm sure you're aware, that there is actually a move at the moment to try and negotiate and draft a binding instrument, a treaty instrument for business and human rights that would indeed hold corporations responsible for their activities. Whether it would offer the same type of protections is another question. I'm a little bit agnostic about this development. I think that not enough time has been given to the Ruggie process and to the core element of the UN guiding principles, the three pillars on protect, respect, and remedy, particularly the remedy pillar. And I think that this is a slow and deliberate process. I don't think it's one that can emerge quickly. Various attempts to actually try and regulate transnational corporations, beginning with the committee that existed in the UN and on which Thomas Veldy served for many years, and Carl Savant, who's still in the area of investment, operated after Veldy left. That didn't come to anything, and I don't think a treaty will either. I may be overly pessimistic. I actually have a PhD student at the moment who's looking at the historical antecedents of the business and human rights regime, including doing archival work at the Dag Hammarskjöld Library on the UNCTC. So I might be able to give you a more specific answer in due course based on her work. But I think it's something for the future. I think it will face huge opposition. In the first day of the meeting of the working group for a binding international treaty, the EU delegation made a statement and walked out, which kind of gives you a flavour of where we are with, but that could be a bit of posturing as well. So I'm not overly optimistic. I'm not saying it never, but it could take a long time. And then, sorry, I'm just reminding myself, your question was very simple. It was about the...
It was when I was over-ambitious.
Yes, over-ambitious. Yes, I think it was. I think it was an extremely ambitious agenda. And in fact, I was reflecting on that when I looked not so much at the declaration, the programme of action, but when I looked at the Charter on Economic Rights and Duties of States. And I was actually trying to find all the references to equality and also to equity. And I just thought to myself, my goodness, it's just trying to do so much. But of course, it's the product of an extensive discussion and negotiation among the developing countries. It comes out of sort of UN meetings and conferences, which tend to be very long and wordy anyway. But I think it was trying to redress too many past injustices, if you like, and to reset the balance. I think perhaps where it could and should, it should have probably slimmed down the number of aims and the scope of them, and it's no surprise that many of them were not fulfilled. I think what's more interesting actually is what has been left and how it has been developed, particularly in the areas of trade, investment and monetary affairs. And then coming to the sort of historical antecedents of the new international economic order, and you're thinking more of the issue with respect to China and how that's changing perhaps.
Also the role of the United States.
Yeah, the role of the United States and then also of China.
Yeah.
Yes, I mean the whole thing is that the US hated this. They hated this NIAO. And I mean, you can still pick up sort of encyclopedia entries, and some of them written quite recently by American scholars, where they just talk about it being a sort of a Marxist venture. You know, this is just anathema to any respectable US diplomat. There was very strong opposition, particularly in the area of foreign investment, to the idea of having appropriate compensation. There was also the idea mooted of just compensation, just in the sense of fair, not meaning just a bit of compensation, but just as in fair. And they saw this as completely and utterly redundant. This was a non-starter. It had to be the whole formula, prompt, adequate, and effective, or nothing. So, you know, this would be, you had to protect foreign investors. But many of, the American view was also colored by the fact that America was the major exporter in terms of trade. Also, there was more foreign direct investment conducted by Americans and some other developed countries at the time. And of course, the US dollar was, you know, at the center of the, particularly because oil then and today is still denominated in US dollars. And that greenback, as they used to call it, was, you know, out there. So this was the currency, and they had a powerful influence over the whole process. It's only in the most recent election, for example, of a non-US head of the World Bank. So we have a South Korean, I think it is, who is now head of the World Bank. That's the first time in the history of that organization that we've actually moved away from US dominance. So where does China stand with respect to this? Well, China has a different approach to development, and it's really development in the eyes of what's good for China, and particularly in exploiting natural resources in the extractive industries in China, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa. There have been reports, I don't know how true they are, but there's been violation of human rights in that a lot of Chinese prison labor is used in construction, in the construction industry, and in extractives in Africa. So Chinese prison labor, this violates human rights conventions. Also, development with Chinese characteristics means that in many countries in Africa today, you get the whole package. So you get development aid, you get your roads built, your schools, your healthcare centers, and things like this. But you also have to put up with Chinese laborers. It doesn't necessarily bring more employment to local people. And maybe environmental standards aren't upheld, human rights are not observed. And a lot of it is just a kind of slash and burn policy. So when the development's done, the Chinese will be out. And I'm being overly probably negative here, but also there's the ideological aspect too. You know, every country has its Confucius Institute. Mind you, we have one at the University of Nottingham, so. But then we have a Chinese campus, so.
Okay, thank you. Gordon? Some other person? Okay, so we have just one more.
My opinion is about the new.
Okay. Just wait, Wood, yeah.
My question is about the new international economic order that you did mention at the beginning of the lecture.
Yeah, and I came back to it a little bit at the end, yes.
My problem is the proposals that were put in place by developing countries, which set the ball rolling, those countries do not still seem to have benefited anything from all these, but there's this much talk about a new international economic order. Quite significant events are happening of recent, which might probably create that new international economic order with Brexit and Trumpism, you did mention, and lots of things happening. Do you see that this might be a turning point where the developed nations are actually now feeling the pinch of what the developing countries have been facing in order to put in place the proposals that led to the new international economic order?
So I didn't quite catch that last part. So you feel that you're talking about the developed countries now will feel more what the developing countries have been
the
suffering?
Developed countries, Britain, for example, is it in a position where they are not feeling what the developing countries felt then in order to put the new economic order?
To be honest, I don't think so. But maybe after we've been through a long, complex, and probably very difficult negotiation with the European Union and plenty of other trade partners, I think we might possibly be in that position. This is something actually that worries me a lot about this so-called Brexit debate. It focuses actually too much on trade. It's all about trade. It's as if trade is the only thing we need to, you know, it's the only thing that our bread and butter consists of. But what about our relations in the area of human security? The security of the person, the security of the environment, human rights. What are those going to look like in a post-Brexit world for us in here in the UK? And I would like to see a lot more attention given to that area as well. And will we be able to redress that imbalance that Theresa May herself has highlighted, the profound inequality that exists in our country. We've become one of the most unequal countries of the whole of the OECD bloc in the last 10 years. We had huge disparities of wealth and income within this country. And we're one of the poorest in Europe in terms, and we're one of the worst at catching up. So we could actually find ourselves being in a much less advantageous position in due course. So it bears thinking about, yes. I'd like to see, as I say, much more attention given to the flanking policy areas, some of which were addressed in the NIO. Yeah. I saw another hand up in the middle there.
If I can just step in there and abuse my chair position and ask questions relating to the one you've just answered. Hypothetical question, perhaps. Who knows? Maybe you'll be asked. If you were to be asked to give advice to the Foreign Office or to the Department of International Trade, what would you tell them going forward from the perspective of this new international economic order, some of the remnants? What rule, or how can Britain kind of design a rule for itself going forward?
That's very difficult because, well, I mean, there's another development I find very troubling, this idea that we will stitch together the old Commonwealth. This is the latest thing that's going the rounds. And, we could just have new forms of colonialism and dependency, and doesn't bear thinking about, but that could also be a real issue for us. But what would I advise the Foreign Office to do? One very simple thing. Realize the importance of global value chains. No one talks about that, but that's what trade is about, that's what investment is about, that's where money flows. Global investment chains, and many of them flow, unfortunately for us, through Europe, because that's where our primary global value chain exists. So that's what I would say. That needs much more consideration. Very simple example of that is to look at car production. There's an idea that we have a motor industry in this country. We don't. We have an assembly. We have a car assembly industry. And we shouldn't kid ourselves. That's what we have, because we're part of a global value chain.
It falls within the idea of industrialization project, yeah.
Okay. Well, this is one of the prongs of the May government's strategy, is to have a new industrial strategy. Yeah, will that bring jobs back? Maybe. We're now looking to upgrade technical skills. When we compare ourselves to many continental countries, Germany is a very good example. Never got rid of its technical schools or its technical grammars. We did that years ago, decades ago. So there is something to be said for that. I'm with Baldwin that, the future lies with technology and also robotics. Now, I didn't give you the example, one I think he alludes to. Think about this already. You can have a surgeon who operates on a patient, let's say complicated heart surgery, a surgeon who is actually operating from the United States, but the patient is somewhere in South Africa. But you could also, now that's between two relatively developed countries, but you could also have the situation where robotics is also, a lot of that work is done in developing countries. So for example, you could have a group of workers in Kenya who are actually remotely cleaning hotel rooms in New York.
Yeah, that's a possibility.
They can do this through robots. They can guide and steer and tell robots what to do, which rooms to go into, what areas they need to clean, and perhaps do it more effectively and more efficiently. You don't need an army of people to do that. So there are many ways that you could use telematics. I think we're not really, and robotics, and we haven't really begun to explore that. I did read, though, actually, there's one troubling development in Japan. They've been using robots to try and clean up the Fukushima plant, and they're dying or being destroyed, and they don't actually know why. So they've now got to understand what the relationship is, obviously, between perhaps radiation and robotic functions. So that's a new dilemma. But you haven't had a chance to ask your question.
You were talking about the new international economic order, and you mentioned that we may have to implement policies that we'd never thought of. Could you give us some examples?
Sorry, you may have
implement policies that, you know, we hadn't considered before. Could you give us some examples?
Well, one would be this use of robotics and this sort of more use of remote objects and services. Actually, it's a sort of a core extension of services. This used to have a wonderful name here in the UK. It used to be called Invisibles. And in fact, there used to be an institute in London called British Invisibles. I just love that word. But it referred to all those areas of service trade, and particularly financial services and all the... so you can think of those areas of the economy that are stimulated or developed through various... so it could be services, telematics, robotics. So not involving human action necessarily, perhaps partly. And so we could see... the other thing that's changing is the kind of technology that's being used in the financial services industry. Or even, and it creates also new dilemmas for us. Even, for example, the electric car, that creates huge problems for insurers, because if the electric car that is sort of remotely operating, it's a bit like a robot, you know, if it has an accident, who's responsible for it? So we've got, you know, new areas and issues of liability. So I think we've got to sort of begin to look at how we're doing things and how some of these changes that are being brought about by technology and robotics and so on are going to actually make us think, and maybe think more creatively. And I think the leaders, the first movers on this, will be those that do the creative work. We need to go much further and think more broadly and think outside the box as well.
Okay, I think with that note, I would just like to thank you again, Mary.
Thank you for
inviting me. And thank you
me.
To Maureen and Margot for your very brilliant talk. Can we put our hands together for the speaker, please?